Welcome to Stuff to Blow Your Mind, a production of iHeartRadio's How Stuff Works.
Hey, welcome to Stuff to Blow Your Mind. My name is Robert Lamb.
And I'm Joe McCormick, and today we've got a treat for you. It's a conversation with Dr. Diva Amon.
That's right. This is a wonderful chat where we're going to talk about deep sea exploration. What is it like to explore the deep ocean from someone who's been there? Mm-hmm. And then what sorts of organisms and ecosystems are we learning about? How much do we not know about the deep ocean? And what are some of the biggest threats facing the deep ocean?
Yeah. So this was a fascinating conversation. Obviously, if you want a little bit of background, we've done some episodes about the deep sea in the past. We'll link to a few of those on the landing page for this episode. I think we've done quite a few within just the past 6 months or so. We've had deep sea on the brain.
Yeah, but the short version is that the ocean is deep. It's so deep that the pressure down there is intense. The darkness is absolute. And yet even in
these—
And it's cold. But even in this environment that is so hostile to human life, there is a great abundance of marine life to be found there.
And gorgeously strange and diverse habitats and ecosystems arise.
That's right. So without further ado, let's jump into the interview.
All right, Diva, thank you so much for joining us. Can you tell our listeners a little bit about yourself?
So my name is Dr. Diva Amon. I'm a deep sea biologist who's originally from Trinidad and Tobago in the Caribbean, but I'm currently based at the Natural History Museum in London in England.
And what do you do there?
Well, it really varies day to day, quite a lot. So probably the best part of my job is actually going out to sea on what we call research cruises. They're nothing like the cruises that most people think about. they don't involve, you know, elderly individuals or all you can eat buffets, definitely not. Yeah, that most of what I do centers around that fieldwork, which can be for about, you know, 1 to 3 months of a year, usually broken up into 4 to 5 week periods. And when we're on that ship, we basically explore parts of the deep sea that most people haven't ever been to, that sometimes no one has ever been to. And we collect samples of animals, of the geology, the rocks and so on, water samples, and that allows us to get a better understanding for that area of the ocean. And then once the research crew is done, we bring everything back to the lab, and there we work on those samples for usually the remainder of the year. And that involves doing, depending on what questions we're asking, a variety of analyses. And then I also do a lot of science communication because I think it's super fun and super important. And that's not just to the public, but also to policymakers to try and make sure our oceans are managed in a more sustainable and effective way. Yeah, it's great. I love what I do.
Oh, it sounds amazing. So you talked about how science communication is a part of your job. If you could isolate, you know, like one thing that you really wish everyone could understand about the oceans or the deep sea that not enough people have grasped, what do you think that message is?
Oh, wow. Let me think about this one.
Didn't mean to put you on the spot.
No, it's great. It's a great question. I think it would probably be two things. The unknown nature, you know, most people never even think about the deep ocean. It's completely out of sight, out of mind. And that unfortunately has a lot of implications for its management and how we treat it. And while it may seem very out of sight and out of mind, it actually is not out of our grasp. On every research cruise that we go on, we see our impacts in the deep sea. And so it would probably be to, you know, hammer home that even though it's this place that most people will never go to, that most people will never get the opportunity to experience, you know, we're still having a very, very real impact in this place that also is really, really important to us being here on the planet.
And do changes in the deep ocean and the deep sea, do we see those having consequences that cascade out to, you know, parts of ecology in the world that we do interact with more?
Yeah, absolutely. So again, not a lot of people realize that, you know, everything is connected, and the deep ocean is the largest ecosystem on the planet. You know, it occupies about 60% of the planet's surface and provides over 96% of all the habitable space on Earth. And so, I mean, this is really a huge area. And because of that huge size, it has a really, really big responsibility. It plays a role in these global processes that really regulate our planet. So things like regulating temperature, it absorbs the majority, I think it's absorbed about 96% of heat from our atmosphere so far, as well as 20-something percent, I don't know the exact figure offhand, of carbon dioxide emissions. And so, you know, regulating the world's climate, which we all know is getting more and more important, it also cycles nutrients, it also detoxifies the shallow parts of our planet. And it provides us with, you know, a range of resources, which a lot of people don't actually realize as well. Things like food, things like oil and gas, in the future, potentially medicine, potentially metals. And there is, of course, this like really inherent cultural value as well. You know, we see deep ocean in so many movies and so many books, and that ability to inspire is really something that we shouldn't underestimate at all.
So can you tell us just a little bit about growing up in the Caribbean and how, you know, how that may have inspired your interest in marine biology, but then also how you ended up focusing on the deep?
Sure. Without trying, I'll probably sound quite cheesy. So I grew up in the Caribbean on the islands of Trinidad and Tobago. And I mean, about 30 years ago, there wasn't that much to do there back then. And so it meant that I spent a lot of time outside, in the garden, on the beach, in the ocean. And it just gradually led to this real passion for the ocean and for the things that live there. And there were a lot of things that I really didn't understand or didn't know about the sea and what lived in it. And that really sort of propelled me to decide to study at university marine science. And funnily enough, I actually wanted to do medicine. And my parents were like, no. Why don't you do something that you think you really will absolutely love, which, again, I'm very, very grateful for. Decided to go and study marine biology. And as I said, most people don't think about the deep sea. When I went to do my undergraduate degree, I, you know, knew very little apart from perhaps like one or two animal books where there were pictures of hatchetfish and, you know, giant squid and other things. But it just really wasn't, it just didn't play a big role despite having grown up by the ocean. And it wasn't until my final year, really, that everything sort of fell into place, where I took a deep sea biology course and the lecturer was saying that, you know, over 99% of our deep ocean hasn't yet been explored. And by explored, I mean visualized. Like it hasn't been seen with human eyes, or it hasn't been seen with a camera that takes photos or images. And that just is such a staggering figure, considering we're talking about our own planet. It really hit home that, you know, to be working in deep sea science, you get the opportunity to be a real life explorer. And I think as children, everybody goes through a period of wanting to do that. And yeah, as I said earlier, I just absolutely love what I do. And that's when I decided, hey, I'm going to give this a shot. And since then, no regrets.
Do you think you could sort of place our current understanding of deep sea ecosystems in a little bit of historical context? Like, where did we come from and where are we today in our understanding of these ecosystems?
So while it may sound abysmal, I mean, over 99% of the deep ocean never having been explored, it is better than it's ever been, right? Our knowledge has increased to a point in history where we are able to make better decisions than we ever have been. But it's still really this sort of drop in the bucket. You know, true deep sea exploration started, I think, in the sort of 1800s. One of the most important expeditions was the Challenger expedition. And that went around the world really making the first concerted effort to sample as much as they could in the deep sea. But of course, back then it was mostly, you know, a trawl you throw off the back of the boat and just sort of drag up whatever you can. Whereas now, where the equipment that's being used is so high tech and as a result expensive, which of course is a very, very big limitation, But it means that, yeah, as I said, our knowledge is increasing. We're able to explore these places that no one has ever been in incredibly fine detail and answer questions which have plagued us for, you know, centuries. And unfortunately, still, while that is great and exciting, we still have a huge way to go in order to be able to truly, you know, understand our planet as best we can.